Good afternoon, and welcome to the second of a six-week educational speaker series brought to you in collaboration with Brain Injury Association of Windsor and Essex County, Beyond Disabilities Rehabilitation Network in Windsor, and the Brain Changes Initiative in Toronto. We gratefully thank our partners at the Hôtel-Dieu Grace Healthcare for presenting this series via Zoom. My name is Anna Jurak, and I'm the Executive Director of the Brain Injury Association of Windsor and Essex County. Our mission is to enhance the lives of those affected by an acquired brain injury through education, awareness, and support. It's my pleasure to introduce the presenting sponsor of this series, Greg Monforton and Partners. And for those of you who don't know, Greg founded Greg Monforton's and Partners Injury Lawyers in Windsor more than 40 years ago. This firm has proudly become one of the most sought-after injury law firms in the region, not only because of the great work they do, but also because of their strong relationship with treatment providers and in the community. It is clear they have a common goal of ensuring that their clients have access to the absolute best care. Greg's firm chose to sponsor this initiative because they believe that none of us can do this alone, but that together we can make an important and lasting difference. On behalf of the partners in this series, I'd like to thank Greg and his team for this incredible sponsorship. I'll now turn it over to Melanie Garden, a board member representing the Beyond Disabilities Rehabilitation Network.
Hello, everyone. I'm the secretary of the Beyond Disability Network. We are located physically inside Hôtel-Dieu Grace Healthcare. However, we've been operating virtually because of the pandemic. We're a collaborative network of community-based organizations. We have some members that are not-for-profit, some are charitable, and some are volunteer. We all come together under one umbrella to network, share resources and information, and work together on common projects and issues, and we all lend our individual voices to one strong collective voice on issues that matter. We currently have 19 members, and all of those are organizations that service those living with a chronic disability. Some examples are ALS, brain injury, stroke, amputees, MS, spinal cord injury, or any number of developmental or intellectual or acquired disabilities. We are always open to adding new members, so if you think that you would fit within our umbrella, please reach out. Our goal is to enhance the lives of those living with chronic disabilities. We have a website, beyonddisability.ca, and you can also find us on Facebook. Thanks and enjoy today's presentation.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dr. Matthew Galati. So I'm a medical doctor, brain injury survivor, and the founder of Brain Changes Initiative. So Brain Changes was founded back in 2019, and it was inspired largely by my own healing journey from traumatic brain injury and the lifestyle approach that I use to heal my brain. So our mission through Brain Changes is to improve the standard of care for traumatic brain injury by bringing this lifestyle approach to healing the brain to the forefront of Western medicine through educational events like this amazing webinar series that we're bringing to you today in partnership with our incredible partners, awareness events, and research that we support. So you could find us on Instagram at Brain Changes. And our website is brainchanges.org. So please follow us and look at our website. We have a lot of great resources for healthcare providers and people with brain injuries and their families. So I would like to thank our partners for helping us bring this speaker series to you today. And I would like to thank our speaker, Heather Condello, for this amazing talk. And on that note, I would like to hand it over to Renee, our moderator for today.
Thank you, Matt. Yes, so my name is Renee Canarudi. I'm a speech language pathologist in the Windsor Essex area. So to begin with, just a few things that we want to discuss is the question and answers. We'd like you to click on, and if you have any questions under that tab at the bottom of your screen, we would encourage you to use this function. We will not be using the chat at this time or the hand, the waving hand. So if you have any questions, we really encourage you to use that link or that tab. And also at the end of the session, we will be recording the whole lecture. So following the session, You will receive it at the end. All the attendees will receive a copy. So I would like to introduce Heather Condello. Heather is an occupational therapist with around 18 years experience. A majority of her career has been as an occupational therapist in the community, focusing on neurorehabilitation with both adults and children. In 2008, she was the co-founder of Complex Injury Rehab, which is a community-based treatment organization. She has since launched Complex Injury Rehab Brain, Spine, and Mental Health Clinics and co-founded BrainFX. Her clinical practice encompasses education, technology, skilled therapeutic intervention, and community engagement. She focuses also on concussion recovery. As a Canadian Certified Life Care Planner, Heather also completes future cost care reports. So we look forward to hearing from Heather. Heather, welcome.
Thank you. All right, hello everybody. I'm going to share my screen.
Next medical professional.
Oh, hold on.
The next symptom to emerge.
Okay, so thanks for joining me today. I'm going to talk to you today about occupational therapy and acquired brain injury rehab, focusing in on cognitive rehab in particular. I would be remiss if I didn't start, before I get into things, to just give credit to a couple of my colleagues as well. Selena Huang, who's an incredibly talented occupational therapist I work with, and Aisha Upal, who's an occupational therapy assistant. Both of them helped me with this presentation, in particular, making it look very pretty. So just for agenda today, we are going to cover first what exactly is occupational therapy, just to make sure people are familiar with what an OT does. We'll touch briefly on what is out there in terms of expert recommendations for ABI recovery. We will talk about OT in the community. We'll explain a bit about what cognitive rehab is, and then I will talk more specifically about how a neuro-OT works to help clients improve their cognition and in turn their overall functioning after an acquired brain injury. So occupational therapy is a discipline that works on the whole person. An OT will work on helping people get back to the activities they love doing in their daily life. So in doing that, we look at areas of self-care, areas of productivity, which can include work, can include caregiving, can include volunteering or school, can include work around the house, and also social and leisure activities. And we look at those activities in the individual's different environments, their unique environments, and all the unique aspects of that person, and how do they all play together, and with the overall goal of helping people get back to doing things that are important to them. So I'm just going to play a video, which hopefully will work well, to explain a little further about what OT is.
When your health changes, it can feel like you are always waiting on the next medical professional, the next symptom to emerge, the next treatment to begin. It can feel like you are always waiting for the next thing to happen to you. But at the core of occupational therapy, we believe that no matter what comes your way, whether it's an illness, an injury, or disability, you and your loved ones still have the power to influence your health in the ways that matter to you. Occupational therapists know that a vital part of healing is staying involved with the life you have worked so hard to build. And that means finding ways to engage in the activities you love and to spend time with the people that you love. We know that even when your health has changed, you are still a mother, a driver, a teacher, an engineer, an athlete. We work with you and your loved ones to help you heal, to help you get stronger. And when it's necessary, we help you choose the best technology and equipment to help you stay involved. That's because occupational therapy is all about keeping you at the heart of the matter. We work with you and your loved ones to help you live a life you love. To learn more about
Okay. So what then is a neuro-occupational therapist? So neurological conditions affect all aspects of life, physical abilities, mental clarity, psychosocial factors, including stress and mood. So a neuro-OT focuses on facilitating an individual's, in any individual's living with neurological conditions, facilitating their ability to maximize and enable their independence in meaningful activities and with all aspects of their daily living. This may involve working on physical functioning, such as balance or mobility of their upper extremity or hand. It might involve addressing challenges with cognition and would also involve addressing any psychosocial impact that the injury is having on their life and their ability to engage in their daily routine. So an important piece that factors into the way a neuro-OT practices is neuroplasticity. So neuro-based occupational therapy does take advantage of our nervous system's resiliency and neuroplasticity in order to reorganize, reform, and strengthen the pathways in our brain. So neuroplasticity refers to the brain's ability to form and reorganize its connections in novel ways, often in a response to new learning, new experiences, or following injuries. It's important to highlight this does not happen overnight. It is like learning any new skill or habit. It takes time and repeated practice in order for the brain to sprout newer and more efficient pathways. So how can we train our nervous system to facilitate neuroplasticity? So this is a little bit sciencey, so bear with me for a minute, but when we come across an unpleasant stressor, so something that causes us pain or anxiety, we attempt to respond to it to reduce that negative experience through a coping strategy. So these responses are called coping strategies, and some are more effective than others. Good coping strategies help us to reduce the negative symptoms through repetition every time the symptoms come up. So our nervous system learns that the stressor is not so bad and that we can handle it. On the other hand, if we have poorer coping strategies, the negative symptoms are not relieved and the nervous system will learn that the stressor is disproportionately bad because we're still experiencing symptoms. So that can lead to worsening symptoms because the nervous system doesn't trust that we're taking care of the problem per se, even though we are trying our best to do so. So through neuroplasticity, we can relearn how to do things we used to do, but in a different way. And we can rebuild regular patterns for activity. So I just want to touch on some of the expert recommendations that are available. So for example, the Ontario Neurotrauma Foundation has guidelines for health professionals to follow and reference, as well as for the general public to have access to. And they outline expert recommendations for recovery following an acquired brain injury. They have one set of guidelines for concussion or mild traumatic brain injury. And these guidelines break it down into different time periods post-injury. So in the acute phase, which they classify as 0 to 4 weeks post-injury, the guidelines recommend the focus of rehab is on optimizing recovery through education, support, and sub-symptom threshold training. So that means training below a level that really flares symptoms, as well as through non-pharmacological interventions. In that post-acute phase from weeks 4 to 12, expert guidelines recommend if the symptoms are continuing to consider implementing interdisciplinary treatment to address persistent symptoms. and really focus on managing the primary symptoms of disturbance. So sleep disruption, post-traumatic headache, any mood-related symptoms. And then ideally through this period, incorporating a gradual return to activity, whatever that is. So if it's school or work or sport. And then for the persistent symptoms that just hang on after 3 months and still continue to be a challenge or even debilitating for individuals who've had an acquired brain injury that's classified as on the more mild level, the guidelines support ongoing interdisciplinary treatment for symptom management and really the importance of developing an individualized management plan for that individual to help them get back to their pre-injury activities. There are also a separate set of guidelines for moderate to severe traumatic brain injury. These guidelines outline that in the acute phase, it's important to initiate timely specialized interdisciplinary rehab as soon as medically allowed. Assessment and planning of rehab should be done through a coordinated team approach that is focused on the individual client. And responds to their needs and changes over time as appropriate. And the treatment really should consist of a multidisciplinary team. A list of those types of professionals is on the slide here. And ideally, there's also some sort of individual who takes on a role of a case coordinator or a case manager to help just coordinate all these different professionals and ensure everyone's working in the best interest of the client and working well together. Also, the guideline just notes the importance of addressing any comorbid issues to ensure, you know, those are being addressed as part of the recovery. So the journey towards recovering from an acquired brain injury is a path that people follow along. And, you know, the path starts with the injury, often starts with, you know, the acute medical management, whether that's hospital or management at home. And really that initial focus is on kind of the surviving, like the, you know, if there's trauma, dealing with the immediate trauma and maybe scans in a hospital to address any, if there's any bleeding in the brain, et cetera. And then progresses from there to starting to relearn different basic skills. And you'll see as the visual outlines as people move along this path back into the community. They first get some connection to support services and then progress in their ability to relearn or get back to the activities they were doing before the injury. And so an OT really works with clients through along this entire pathway. So along their full journey as they are recovering from an acquired brain injury. I'm just going to go back. Okay, so what more specifically does an OT do in the early stages with someone following an acquired brain injury? So an occupational therapist will typically start with a comprehensive assessment. That assessment would involve a clinical interview with the client and those close to them. It would involve questionnaires to explore various symptoms. It would involve functional demonstration of activities, and it would involve some standardized assessment tools to assess different areas, including in-depth functional cognitive assessment. As OTs, we look at, as part of this assessment, all these different aspects of someone's daily routine, so different areas of self-care, productivity, and leisure. And we look at, as I mentioned before, all the different environments that an individual operates within in their daily life, all the different components of them as a person, and how those interplay with their occupations, which are those areas of self-care, productivity, and leisure, and overall their quality of life and their well-being. Next, an OT will often also be involved right from the start. So often helping a client and their family as they go through the hospital discharge process. So getting out of hospital back into their home community. Or if they haven't been in hospital, even just, you know, their initial stages at home in terms of finding services and supports for them within their community. Looking at any equipment needs and prescribing and ensuring required equipment is in place, making referrals for other support services. So often an OT, because they're involved so early, they also take on this care coordination role and are referring for other, so for example, physiotherapy or to a social worker, or maybe even just keeping track to make sure they're getting the required medical follow-up. And then also connecting individuals to their local community resources and programming, and helping them just understand how to navigate this new system that they're all of a sudden thrown into through having an acquired brain injury. From there, an OT who works in the community, once the client is kind of settled and safe at home, the OT will work on treatment with clients. Typically, we refer to treatment as being goal directed. So, you know, the client identifying their most important goals and the OT working with them towards those. So that this treatment can include ongoing education, strategies for managing symptoms of acquired brain injury, setting goals, working on areas such as sleep or anxiety management, cognitive rehab, starting to develop new routines and new ways of going about their day and their week, and then also helping them, client facilitating their ability to get back to activities they love, such as sports and work. So what are the different areas of cognition? So before we get into talking about what we do for cognitive rehab, just to touch on all the different areas of cognition. So as you can see on this slide, there's multiple areas of cognition, and a community neuro OT will work to investigate, assess all these different areas, and then the impact it has on the client's life. So that can include areas of perceptual motor function, different areas of language, learning and memory, social cognition, different areas of attention, and the term executive functioning. So that's a term that's often thrown out there that some people don't know what that means, but basically all executive functioning is just those more complex aspects of our thinking. So planning and organizing, making decisions and multitasking and being able to see things from different perspectives. Executive functioning fits into all of that. And it's just important to note as well that sometimes cognitive challenges exist or persist under the radar for a while, but then reveal themselves as an individual starts to go back to more complex or challenging tasks. So a community OT will keep tabs on that as individuals progress from, you know, the basic activities that they first start getting back to into more complex tasks such as work or helping children with their schoolwork. So how does this apply in real life? Just some examples here. So an individual who is having difficulty with attention and concentration, they might find themselves easily distractible, repeating questions often, having difficulty following conversations or zoning out in conversations or just in general when they're out. Someone who has difficulty with processing speed will find it just takes them much longer to do things. So whether that's longer to take in information they're hearing, longer to come up with what they want to say, any task they're doing, it takes them longer to think through how to do it. Someone with challenges with learning and memory might notice they forget instructions, they forget conversations, or they have trouble following through on tasks they want to do or have been asked to do during the day. And then again, these executive functions. So would notice challenges with multitasking and with planning. Sometimes also even with controlling emotions can come into play here. Okay, so then what is cognitive rehabilitation? So cognitive rehab is a therapeutic approach aiming to improve different areas of cognitive functioning. So all those areas that were on the slide a couple of slides ago, attention, learning and memory, problem solving, executive functioning. It involves working to retrain and restore lost functions. And the emphasis is on training activities within the context of everyday life, ideally, so that we can facilitate carryover. Cognitive rehab operates on the principle that enriched and enhanced learning environments can promote gains via neuronal plasticity. And really, cognitive rehab has to be considered within a framework that considers each individual's pre-injury characteristics. So who they were before, the stage of their development and the stage of their recovery, and the personally meaningful activities for that individual and the context in which they do those activities. So as such, you know, given there's a lot of heterogeneity in terms of physical, cognitive, behavioral, psychosocial impairments following an acquired brain injury. So each individual's injury is different and the impact it has and the presentation is different. Rehab really has to be individualized and a focused approach on that individual's goals, needs, resources, and areas of challenge. So cognitive rehab is typically tailored to specific cognitive functions and recognizes a key component of medical care following acquired brain injury. And early stimulation of cognitive functions promotes this brain plasticity and helps people recover from the areas that have been damaged. So cognitive rehab typically involves one or both of two approaches. So one approach is remediation. So this approach attempts to retrain directly those cognitive processes that have been impaired following the acquired brain injury. And the other one is compensation. So compensatory training seeks to develop new compensatory skills to enhance performance on everyday tasks, such as driving or baking, and assumes that the individual will learn to compensate for their challenges with newly learned strategies used using retained cognitive skills that they have and functional reorganization of the brain. So for example, using compensatory strategies, an OT would look at new ways of accomplishing an activity, finding strategies or techniques or using adapted tools that work around a client's challenges. So for example, using a day planner to plan out and remind people about their schedule or using reminder functions on a cell phone to compensate for poor memory or a plate guard to prevent food from slipping off a plate if someone has challenges with functional use of one hand. In a remediation approach, on the other hand, interventions targeted towards improving performance components with the assumption that these improvements will lead to enhanced occupational performance. So remedial approaches can include breaking tasks down into chunks, reteaching skills, and using different teaching approaches. Remedial approaches tend to focus on repetition to help with skill development. And as I mentioned previously, really important that all activities really ideally should be practiced in the most realistic and appropriate environment for the person with a brain injury. And include opportunities for them to keep practicing skills outside of direct sessions with the therapist. It's important to remember cognitive rehab is an ongoing process. So there's going to be gains and there might be a little bit of a setback, then gains again, maybe a period of plateau. It's a process. Research indicates that for an individual with an acquired brain injury to achieve generalization of new skills and strategies to daily activities, cognitive rehab really needs to focus on activities that are meaningful to the individual person. And as I mentioned, these activities ideally should be provided in the person's own environment and really adapted for their own life. Okay, so what are some examples of cognitive remediation activities? So one of the important pieces, I guess, to remember is a lot of variety is important, and incorporating novel or new tasks is important as well. So if you, you know, you just keep, so for example, like using the first on the list here, Sudoku, if you just keep doing Sudoku puzzles over and over and over again, that's not going to generalize to all these different areas of life. And is only really involving certain aspects of cognition. Again, if you think back to that slide with all the different areas of cognition, Sudoku doesn't target each one of those. So if there's multiple areas of challenge, doing just one thing isn't going to help an individual recover in all those areas. So variety and then novel tasks as well. So incorporating new activities that really challenge the brain to figure out how to do these new activities. The brain, you know, can work on autopilot really nicely with things that are very familiar. So incorporating novel is important. And so having a big variety. So for example, at home, you know, doing a bunch of games and puzzles, reading books is great, even starting with reading shorter articles. So if reading a book is too challenging, just reading a few lines to start, or a paragraph of an article to start, and slowly building up ability to read for longer, and reading on a variety of topics again to stimulate the brain in different ways. If reading is too challenging, or again, just as another source of variety, listening to podcasts or TED Talks. And the great thing with podcasts and TED Talks is you can choose short ones to start and then build up tolerance as you get better. Learning a new language or a new instrument. Again, this is just great for getting those neurons in the brain firing and forcing them to start working. Trying to find another new skill to learn, or taking a course. And just incorporating different levels of cognitive challenge into daily life is important. So in a minute, we'll get into more what a therapist might do in session, but for an individual with a brain injury, between therapist sessions, just to focus on working on how can I force myself to improve my memory. So if I'm going to go to the store, try and remember my list of 5 items in my head, I'll have it on my phone or on a piece of paper as a backup, but really forcing yourself to try and incorporate cognitive challenge into those aspects of your, into any aspect of your daily life as well. So there is also numerous pen and paper type activity books for brain injury cognitive rehabilitation. There's an example here, the brain injury workbook. You can get that just through chapters, Indigo, and basically it includes some education on different areas of cognitive function and some worksheets that are then associated with that. There's various games you can play online. So there's one example here, Games for the Brain, and you'll see this picture on the side here of a puzzle. So this Dragger game, for example, Games for the Brain has multiple games, but one called Dragger, there's all the puzzle pieces and you have to, you know, drag them into the correct square to solve the puzzle and put the pieces in the right order to get the proper picture displayed. There's also Lumosity, Posit Science, there's all kinds of online cognitive games. And I think the key really is variety again. So, you know, don't just do Lumosity every single day, but switch it up and do a whole variety of cognitive activities. And another example is Happy Neuron. There's a Happy Neuron Standard and a Happy Neuron Pro for clinicians to use. But it's another example of a digital therapy tool that to engage in cognitive rehab. I'm going to show you an example on the next slide of one of their games. So basically with Happy Neuron Pro, it's the clinician can prescribe the exercises So they can choose from all the different exercises available and put together a custom program for a client. And they can also adjust the level of difficulty in a number of different ways. So customizing settings, and then monitor the client's progress with the games over time and continuously adjust. So you'll see in the video at the beginning, how the therapist can adjust some of those settings. Okay, so that was an example of happy neuron. So I thought we would just, I know this isn't really interactive and I'm just talking at everyone, but I thought we would try and play a little bit of a game here to take a break from just listening and blankly kind of staring at the screen. So this would be an example of something an OT might do to help a client work on short-term memory. So basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to read out a short classified ad, and I'll get you to just kind of listen, and then I'm going to ask some questions about the ad. So after I read it, just think to yourself if you can answer each of the questions. So we'll try two of these. So the first one is, the ad is for customer service. Customer service rep needed for 6 months. Must type 35 words per minute and have data entry skills. Needs to be bilingual in English and Spanish. Call Bob and personnel at 555-3321. Okay, so now just think to yourselves as I read these questions if you're able to answer them. So what is the category of the help wanted ad? What kind of job is the ad for? How long will the project last? What foreign language will the person need to know? And who should the applicant call in the personnel department? Okay, so we'll try one more of those. So this is the second ad. So the category is puppies. Two registered chow pups, both female, 10 weeks old, had all shots, one golden, one black, $100 each. Call 555-5768. Okay, so now just think to yourself if you can answer any of these questions. What kind of puppies are for sale? What gender are the puppies? How old are the puppies? What color are the puppies? And how much is the owner asking for the puppies? Okay, so there are also multiple standardized cognitive rehab programs that occupational therapists might choose to use as part of a comprehensive cognitive rehab program with clients. That includes goal management training. So goal management training involves strategies in problem solving, prioritizing goals, and inhibiting attention to less relevant and distracting information. There's also attention process training, also referred to as APT. So APT is direct attention training aimed at improving underlying attention deficits post-acquired brain injury. And it involves intensively presented attention drills that stimulate impaired components of attention to in turn enhance corresponding processing abilities. There is a program called CogMed. CogMed's an evidence-based computerized training program designed to improve attention by effectively increasing working memory. And there is also a program put together by ABI Wellness called the BEARS program. This program uses a brain EX program and targets four different areas of the brain responsible for executive functions. to then help restore one's ability to organize, to plan and set goals, and to build cognitive capacities in different areas, including verbal memory and verbal retrieval and reasoning. So in addition to the activities one can do at home and some of the workbooks or other online activities, an OT might choose to incorporate some of these standardized programs as well. And then just another piece which has to be incorporated is application to functional activity. So, you know, even if an OT is doing CogMed with a client, they also want to be working on strategies in the context of functional activity to help promote carryover. I would be remiss if I didn't also mention some of the other factors that OTs address as part of a cognitive rehab program that aren't specifically working on cognitive rehab, but addressing other factors that would impact someone's ability to benefit from cognitive rehab. So for example, sleep, fatigue, mood, anxiety, pain, vision and vestibular challenges, all of these can impact someone's ability to engage in cognitive rehab activities. So for example, and I know there will be other talks in the coming weeks, so I'm not going to get into detail on these, but you know, an OT will incorporate working on deep breathing or mindfulness and relaxation to help an individual with managing anxiety so that then they can better engage in cognitive rehab activities. An OT will often work on addressing sleep, multiple ways to address sleep, but helping an individual to improve their sleep. Again, if someone's not sleeping well, they're not going to be able to engage well in a cognitive rehab program. So working on some of these other foundational pieces as part of the cognitive rehab program. And another important component that we as OTs incorporate a lot is the use of pacing strategies. You know, when someone's very symptomatic or has a lot of fatigue following an acquired brain injury, it's imperative to incorporate pacing so that you can slowly build up tolerances without getting too frustrated or flaring symptoms too much. So I'm going to play this video, which talks about planning and pacing. It's from, as you can see, Laura Graham, who's a physiotherapist at Parkwood. So Parkwood in London has an excellent concussion rehab program. And so I'm going to play this for you.
Hi, I'm Laura, and I'm a physiotherapist on the acquired brain injury outpatient team at Parkwood. And I'm going to talk to you today about using a timer to help you plan and pace your activity. We know that it is becoming common knowledge that you should rest when you get a concussion or brain injury, but what may not be as well understood is how to come out of rest and get back to activity and doing the things that we love. Many of our clients will tell us that they feel best when they first wake up in the morning. That the morning might be when they are symptom-free or when their headaches and fatigue are at their lowest. But then with each activity, their symptoms get worse. They might make breakfast, get ready for work, do a chore like washing the dishes, or spend some time on the computer and feel a little worse with each one. Instead of taking a break, they talk to us about trying to push through their symptoms until they finally crash, which might take them hours or days to get back down to their baseline. So if this sounds like you or your client or loved one, you need to make a change. Because pushing through our pain works when we are training at the gym to become stronger or better at a particular sport, but pushing through our symptoms when we have a brain injury does not help our brain to recover. So let me paint you a picture. If in this graph represents your activity, the safe zone is your baseline symptom. So when your symptoms are at their lowest or when you're symptom free. And the line represents your activity. So then the danger zone represents when your symptoms get worse or increased. So in this first scenario, the person is feeling best early on in the day, and with more and more activity, they progressively feel worse as they climb into the danger zone. And then they go through this constant cycle of pushing through their symptoms and crashing. What we need to do is smaller bursts of activity interspersed with rest so that we stay in our safe zone. This allows our brains to recover so that we can progressively do more activity with less rest, represented here by our increased safe zone. So to do this, you can use a timer to set some time restrictions. So for example, if you know that your headache gets worse after 20 minutes of reading or work on the computer, set your timer for 15 minutes and take a 5 or 10 minute break. Taking a break might mean closing your eyes or laying down, or it might mean switching from a cognitive task like reading or working on the computer to a physical task like walking or maybe just folding your laundry. This is not an exact science, but it will help you to self-pace and self-monitor your activity so that you can implement additional changes as you recover. This might include something like our pacing points program that we talk about in our program highlights section of our website, or other additional strategies that you might use could include the use of a day timer or planner to schedule in your activity and rest breaks. If you have memory issues, post your calendar in a place that you will always walk by in the run of a day. Or you can record your activity as appointments in your phone and use an alarm system to alert you when to stop and start the next activity. So remember, doing too much activity will not promote recovery. Planned, structured activity with frequent rest breaks will help to improve your activity tolerance and reduce incidence of increased symptoms.
Okay, and I've just included some additional resources here at the end of the presentation. And that is all. So I guess we can open it up if anyone has any questions.
Okay, so Heather, we have a few questions here. One of them is, what are typical barriers patients face that limit them from participating in cognitive therapy? And what do you do to troubleshoot this?
So I think the first thing that jumps to my mind is, in terms of a barrier, is that it's not of interest to the individual. You know, if we're doing, say, for example, pen and paper activities with someone, and, you know, just the OT keeps coming in and doing these pen and paper activities, and the client has no interest, it just doesn't mean anything to them, they hate these activities, they're probably not going to benefit from it. So finding activities that are enjoyable for the client, and just that's what an OT is really good at, is figuring out how to make it work for each individual client. So really focusing in on what is meaningful and important. Another barrier is, you know, often following a brain injury, having the motivation and being able to initiate doing an activity is hard. So for example, you might, you know, if you're sitting at home and you know, okay, well, I should read a book, or I should do some Lumosity, or I should do a puzzle, but it's hard because of your brain injury to initiate that activity. So that's where participating in therapy, so whether that's with an OT or sometimes with a therapy assistant, for that person just to be able to help you initiate and help you get going and engaged in those activities. And then as you start doing more, hopefully then it just starts to become more part of the day and more routine, that you don't have that issue continuously with trying to initiate activities.
So you're suggesting that they do review it initially in some of the therapies to get them going, that maybe then it becomes part of the routine.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that's the goal over time, right? Is that by doing a variety of activities, including those that are part of their daily life, that then they just start to be able to apply it within their daily life.
Okay, great. There was another question here. I know you did present a few strategies, like such as the grocery store list, and having the items ahead of time listed, but then try to work on memory. one of the questions was asking if you could provide an example of cognitive exercises with an emphasis on everyday context.
Yeah, so the grocery store, for example, or any shopping trip, but also even just making something in the kitchen. So cooking, for example, whether or not you were a cook beforehand, but learning a new recipe. So even starting simple with learning something very basic, but then gradually increasing that challenge. So learning how to cook something new or cook something different and working through the sequence of, you know, what are the ingredients I need? What order do I need to do these steps on? And working it up to be more complex where you've got different things going on and you've got to watch something on the stove while you're chopping some vegetables on the counter or time something in the oven to work out for the other pieces of your meal. So that would be another example. Really just any activity though that's meaningful for you. So if you like being active and like playing sports, figuring out some way to work in memory strategies in some sort of activity that you're doing. So whether it's, shooting baskets on the net, but while you're doing that, working through like calling out animals like A, B, C as you shoot each basket. So there's, ways that you can incorporate into everything that you do, just getting creative and thinking about how to do that.
Okay, great. I have a question here. It says, even if I feel like I can do more, should I still conserve and pace myself accordingly to a plan?
Yeah, so this is a tough one, right? So often I see people who, I'm feeling really good today. I'm just going to get everything done that I haven't been able to do all week. And then all of a sudden, like that graph, like they showed in the video, that graph, right? All of a sudden it's a crash. But at the same time, you want to build up your tolerance for doing activities, absolutely. And the key really is to just take it slowly. And so like in the video, what she suggested with the timer, she also talked about, made reference to a point system. So we will, in our practice, we use this point system and it's kind of like Weight Watchers almost, where you have a certain number of activity points through the day and, you have to figure out how to stick within that number of points. But then as you get stronger and your tolerances increase, your number of points per day can increase. So it's a balance of slowly increasing. So if you're feeling good, do a little bit more, but not to the point where your symptoms are then flaring up and you're in bed for 3 days afterwards. And it's some trial and error to figure that out initially, for sure.
Okay. It's another question says, my dad had a major short-term memory issue. Do you think asking questions such as what day is it is helpful, or just tell them the day?
I think that it's always good to try and challenge an individual. So to try and get their brain thinking of things. Now, if you're constantly asking your dad what the day is and he's just getting really angry, for example, because he can never remember the day, then maybe it's switching strategies and working on memory in a different way. But it is always good to try and not do everything for people, to try and help them really like help promote the neuroplastic change in the brain by making the brain think through and making the brain process information. But you have, again, it's a balance, because you want to do it in a way that doesn't frustrate that individual, so that they just completely stop engaging with you.
Okay. Another question here. For AD resources. So there is somebody, I think, that has had an injury for assistive devices. They do not have services, but was wondering where they could find some sort of assistive device resources with limited funds.
So I guess there's such a spectrum of what an assistive device is. So, an assistive device can be anything from like a bath chair, to augmentative communication equipment, to a smartphone. So it's a bit tough to answer that question globally, but I think my general answer will be reaching out to the local brain injury associations or to the Ontario Brain Injury Association. The people that are part of these organizations are a wealth of knowledge. Even if they don't know the answer, can potentially connect you to people who would in your local community or to other survivors who might have gone along the same path. So I think that would be my recommended starting point, is with your local brain injury association.
Okay, that's great. And maybe OBIA, so the Ontario mm-hmm. Brain Injury Association. So if the individual doesn't know what the local one is, OBIA. Yeah. Would be able mm-hmm. to probably help them as well, at least yeah. find a resource. Okay, great. I have another question. I think that one of the questions asked to if you could post the links, I think it was the last page of your PowerPoint, just so everybody knows that will be also on the recorded and will be sent to attendees. So if they miss it, but they asked if you could put that on. I guess at the end. Another question here, let's go on. It says, on a whole, do you still see substantial cognitive improvement in those that are a year or more out from injury when they are just starting cognitive rehab at that later stage?
So yes, we do see that. There's a lot of people we see who come to us. So often, people will leave the hospital, they maybe haven't had as much intensive community rehab after they've left the hospital, and they'll come to us after a year or a year and a half or 2 years, or, we've had some people come to us even many years later, and we've still been able to see change with some intensive programming, again, that, follows all these different components, right? So it's, applies to their daily life, generalizable, intensive, repetition. And I think one of the key factors really is, you can come for therapy once a week or twice a week or what have you, but it's also your commitment to participating in therapy outside of therapy that's key to get those neuroplastic changes. So, knowing that you're going to have to work hard, and it's kind of like your job, this cognitive rehab is your job for a period of time. But yes, we have seen changes even a year and more post-injury.
Great. Any other types of therapies, such as there are the options of games online, but besides paper, pencil, brain injury workbook type activities, are there any other recommendations that you would, or any other suggestions that you could provide, especially if they have issues with screen time? Because I know some of our clients with ABIs do have issues with the screens.
Yeah. So I think the key will be a variety of activities. So never just relying on one activity, and finding activities that you like. But, even just standard games, board games, right? So I listed some in the presentation, so you'll have those as a resource, but sequence or cards or puzzles, standard games like that, or games that involve some strategy and planning like Risk. But also the new learning that I mentioned. So, thinking about something new that you would want to learn. It doesn't have to be an instrument or a language. It could be just, learning to knit or, some sort of new skill. So something new that you're learning, or listening to talks and then forcing yourself. So to, whether you're stopping after 2 minutes of the talk and just, okay, how much of this talk can I remember? Or listening to the whole talk and then, or, with someone that lives with you as well, both of you listening to the talk and ask that other person, as we listen, come up with some questions to ask me afterwards. Right. And then, so you both listen and then the other person can ask you some questions afterwards. And just, really, any daily activity, forcing yourself to use your brain a little bit more than just relying on the kind of automatically going through the motions with it.
Great suggestions. I think our time is up. I think I'm going to have one more question, and then I think that's it, unfortunately, because we're 1 minute to go. One of the last question was, over time, is the idea to reduce compensatory strategies and increase remediative strategies?
Maybe. It really depends on the person. I mean, there's nothing wrong with having compensatory strategies in place ongoing. And even, you know, I mean, I'm very dependent on my phone as a remind for reminders in my calendar, right? So sometimes the compensatory strategies work really well for people and they're so nicely incorporated into their daily life that it just becomes part of their life. But other times people, like, they just want to keep, you know, I have to get back to work. I can't be relying on this compensatory strategy anymore. So it does vary for sure.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks so much, Heather, for providing us with a comprehensive summary of cognitive rehabilitation. You've reviewed symptoms and provided us with some strategies that we might be able to put in our toolbox and hopefully pull out and review and implement them with some of our clients. So thanks again. And hopefully, I'm not sure if some of these other questions that are still on the list can be answered at a later time. I'm not sure, but I will ask Matt maybe or Nicole to.
Yeah, so we will send out the slide deck, which Heather, I saw you put your email. So I'm assuming you're okay if people reach in via email with some of the questions that maybe did not get answered today. But as always, feel free to reach out to that email address that's sending out the YouTube link for this session, and we can facilitate that if you would like to have some further follow-up questions.
Thank you.
So that'll wrap up our session today. Thank you everyone for attending.